to Destiny Worship Center, where you matter. Thank you for joining our Resurrection Sunday worship service experience. We're excited to have you worship with us today. If you would like to partner with Destiny financially as we continue the kingdom work, you can give in the following ways. Givelify, Destiny Worship Center, Lancaster, Texas. Cash App, DestinyWcc2. Through our website, www.dwcc.org, or you can drop it off at the church on Sundays from 11 to 12:30. God bless the hearers of the word today. Bless the songs given to you and the sermon brought to you. We're excited about what you have in store for our future. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. exhale, inhale and exhale, and allow the presence of God to pervade your space and your place right now. God, we thank you for this moment. Verses, the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter, the first six verses. It says, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came to the sepulchre bringing the spices, which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. They entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass that as they were much perplexed, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed their heads to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee. He is risen, like he said. You don't have to turn there, but we're going to just put a finger on another scripture, well-known, familiar scripture, Romans 6:23, you know it by heart. It simply says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I just want to use as a subject on this morning, I had a root issue. Put it in the atmosphere. I had a root issue. Put it in the chat. I had a root issue. I think for us to get the big picture of the resurrection, that it's important for us to kind of get an understanding of God's thought process. Not that our finite minds could ever grasp the infinite mind of God, but because he loves us, he has allowed us to get a glimpse of his cognitive work. A couple of months ago, a child was stolen from a family. The kidnappers eventually contacted the family and requested $1 million ransom. Kidnappers knew that the family was well off and that shouldn't be an issue. Kidnappers called the family and said, if you ever want to have a relationship with your baby again, you need to come up with $1 million. The family makes a call and immediately they got the money. They contacted the kidnappers, made the exchange, everything went smooth. I said all that to say this, when humanity had sinned against God and severed its relationship with him, the ransom that sin had requested was astronomical. No human could pay the price that was being asked, because the cost to reconcile humanity back to divinity was unblemished blood. So God had to pay the cost that sin was requesting if he ever wanted to have a relationship with his creation again. So sin was attempting to blackmail God. God had never had to pay a cost for anything in life. There was no cost when God said, let there be light. There just was. There was no cost when God said, let the waters bring forth living creatures. There just was. There was no cost when God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures after its kind. It just did. And at the end of all that, God took a look at what he had done, stepped back and said, it's all good. But there was nothing good about this predicament. It took all the love that God had in him to look at devious, hateful, fallen, sinful humanity and say, let me make Calvary. Listen clearly. It was God's love that said, let me send my son to be slain as a lamb. It was God's love that kept him from wiping out humanity from the face of the earth as they nailed Jesus' hands and nailed his feet and pressed a crown of thorns on his head and pierced him in his side. It was God's love that caused him to turn his face when his son said, Father, Father, why 16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him wouldn't perish but have everlasting life. Go on and put it in the chat. He loves me. Go on and put it in the atmosphere. He loves me with all my moles and all my flaws and all my idiosyncrasies and all my shortcomings. What I'm trying to tell you is I'm not perfect, but he loves me. I got a long way to go, but he loves me. I've sinned and come short of the glory of God, but he loves me. I made some mistakes, but he loves me. If you're just glad that Jesus suffered, glad, died, and got up, not for your perfection, but for your purpose, come on and bless him for 5 seconds and tell the enemy he loves me. Come on, 4 more seconds. Tell the enemy he loves me. Come on, 3 more seconds. Tell your neighbor he loves me. Come on and put it in the atmosphere. You got 2 more seconds. Tell the enemy he loves me.
Oh, God.
He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He looked me up, my folks, and saw all my needs. He loves me. His grace covers a multitude of my sins. He loves me. But I bless him because he kept me when he should have killed me, because he loves me. I bless him because some black morning when this life is over, I will, because he loves. God, he loves me. The text says in Luke that the women were on their way to the tomb early in the morning to finish preparing the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. They tells us that when he got there, they made a great discovery. Stone was rolled away and Jesus was risen. I would like to suggest that there may have been many great discoveries in the history of the world, but none of these discoveries rival the discovery made by these two women when they discovered an empty tomb. When they discovered that Jesus had risen from the dead, when they discovered that he got up just like he said he would, when they discovered that he did exactly what he said he was going to do, they made the most significant discovery in human history. Because this discovery changed our interaction with God from being religious to relationship. But here's the tension that each and every one of us must deal with today, and that is we all have to make that same discovery for ourselves. We all have to discover that he lives, God. We all have to come to the conclusion without a shadow of a doubt that God loves me. We all have to come to the conclusion that the grave couldn't hold him. We all have to come to the conclusion that now we have access to the Father through a risen Savior. We all have to make that discovery. But before we can even deal with the after effects of the cross, we have to address the underlying why of the cross. Why do you think Jesus suffered, bled, and died? Why do you think he allowed them to take him from judgment hall to judgment hall? Why do you think he allowed them to beat him unmercifully? Why do you think he allowed them to spit in his face? Why do you think he allowed them to pierce him in his side? Are you ready? He did it because of our sins. It would be irresponsible of me as an expositor, as a homiletic, to elevate the cross without exposing the sin that put him on the cross. That's like going to the doctor and not expecting to talk about what's hurting. You need to know that it was not just murderers and rapists that put Jesus on the cross. It wasn't just muggers and robbers that put Jesus on the cross. It wasn't just rapists and degenerates that put Jesus on the cross. He went to the cross for all the times we acted a fool. He went to the cross for all the times we came up short. He went to the cross for all the times we missed the mark. He went to the cross for all the times we failed to live right or act right or talk right or love right. Can I be transparent for a minute and tell the world, I put it there. God, I know we've been passing the buck for a long time, but the truth of the matter is, he did it for all of us. Granddaddy and them, sweet mama and them. He did it because we were all born with a sin nature. We were all born with the proclivity to do wrong. But here's our shout, God. In spite of our sins, putting him on the cross, our sin couldn't compete with our Savior. Because there's not a sin that the blood can't supersede. There's not a sin that the blood can't wash. There's not a sin that the blood can't cleanse. Let me say, it was the blood. God, I felt that in my spirit. I shout every morning when I get up because I know I'm going to mess up, but the blood. I shout every morning when I get up out the bed because I know I'm going to act a fool, but the blood. I shout every morning when I'm doing what I do every day because I know when I mess up, it's the blood. Someone who has the misconception because you thought you can out-sin God's grace. God. And God told me to tell five of y'all who thought you could out-sin God's grace. He told me to tell you Jesus died for that too. God. Well, whatever you can think of, he died for that too. Every deed, every thought, every lie, every wrong, every mess, every mistake, God told me to tell you he went to the cross for that too. But here's the thing. Don't allow what Jesus died for to cause you not to live. God told me to tell someone who's been allowing their past to get behind the wheel and drive. God told me to tell you, it's time for you to live. It's time for you to move on. It's time for you to start over. It's time for you to wipe your face. It's time for you to turn, God. It's time for you to turn the page. Come on and speak it in the atmosphere and say, live. God, come on and tell yourself today. Today I'm going to live. This is the last time I'm going to cry about this. Today is the day I'm going to live. This is the last time I'm going to even think about you because today is the day I start living. This is the last time I have a nightmare about the hell you put me through. Today is the day I'm going to live. Come on, put it in the atmosphere and say, today is the day I live. I was looking at the Luke and narrative, and it says that sometimes we can find ourselves feeling good about ourselves, but the only reason why we can feel good about ourselves is because we already know the end of the story. We know the answers to the questions, God. But initially, just like the women in this text, many of us operated from a position of corrupted perception. Corrupted perception is when you operate from the perceptions which are tied to your feelings, but they are not tied to any facts. And because your feelings are not tied to any facts, what you've heard, seen, thought, and felt are incorrect. But you're operating as though they were, which leads you to have faulty results. I'm going somewhere. Because the women on the way to the tomb were initially operating from a position of corrupted perception. They felt, you hear what I said? They felt that they were on the way to finish preparing Jesus' body for burial. Even though he had already told them, in 3 days, I'm going to get up, God. But because of what they had saw Jesus go through, And because they had seen him hanging on the cross, because they had seen him pierced in the side, because they had heard him say, "It is finished," because they had felt the pain he was experiencing, their perception, which was tied to their feelings, God, which was not tied to any facts, was that there is no way Jesus can come back from that, God, because they had disconnected what Jesus said from what they saw. And because they had disconnected what Jesus said from what they saw, God, they didn't think he could be healed, God. And that's exactly where the enemy wants us. He wants us to operate from a position of corrupted perception, that where we are is where we're going to stay, and that we will never overcome what we've gone through, that our wound will never heal, that our pain will always persist, that this is the end of the story. But this is corrupted perception, because these feelings, y'all walk with me, are disconnected from our faith, God, because they're not tied to any facts. And God is saying there are times when we have to disassociate our feelings from our faith and remind ourselves that my faith looks up to the old Lamb of Calvary, Savior, to my hear now this prayer I may take all of my sins away. Oh, bless me now this day. Be holy. Now, take your feelings out of it and remind yourself that we walk by faith and not by sight. And today, I'm going to start faithing and stop fearing. Today, I'm going to start faithing and stop fearing. Today, I'm going to start faithing and stop fearing. Let me hear you say, today, God, you just messed the enemy up. You said, today, God, come on, put it in the chat. Say, today, not tomorrow, not even later on today. Say, right now, today, I'm going to start faithing and stop fearing. The text in Luke says when they got to the tomb that the angel had already rolled the stone away. And I missed it. 30 years of preaching, and I missed it. I thought, Dennis, that the angels rolled the stone away so Jesus could get out. I thought that, God. I'm sorry, this is getting me. Destiny, I thought the angels rolled the stone away because they was doing Jesus a favor so Jesus could get out. Because he said, I'm coming out in 3 days. So I thought the angels descended, brought the stone away, so Jesus can get out. But Jesus was already in his resurrected body. Because he didn't need them to move the stone. He could have walked through the stone. So the question on the floor is, why did the angels throw the stone away, God? The angels rolled the stone away. It wasn't about for Jesus' benefit. It was for the two women so they could take a look and see he wasn't there no more. It was for all the witnesses who could go in and take a look and see that he had risen from the dead. So the angels rolled the stone away. It wasn't for his benefit. It was for our benefit. I'm just glad that God is so much God that he allows us to take a look and see what he did, God. Every now and then, God will do something great, not for his benefit, but so we can take a look and say, look at what the Lord has done. Okay. Let's go home. Let me go. Let me give you this. So, I had a project that I undertook on purpose. And I had some huge exposed roots in the back of my fence, on my yard, and I wanted to lay some grass, so Pat, I got the great idea that I was gonna move these big roots out the way. Come, let me hear you say city boy. Take the bass out your voice, you ain't got to say it like that. I am a city boy, so I have never removed roots before. And so I go out and I Googled how to remove exposed roots. And so I saw how to do it, so I go in the backyard to remove these roots. So I'm out there and I'm removing roots. And so Mia comes out and she said, "Daddy, what you doing?" I said, "I'm removing roots now," because she knows her daddy has never removed no roots. She says, "Okay." It goes back inside. So I'm removing roots. I'm removing roots. And Kevin, I found out that I can easily remove the big exposed roots. Easy. No problem. Bam. Bam. I'm removing the big roots. But then something happened. George, I almost yanked my arm out of socket. I had cut the big root that was exposed. Let me use the exposed. I had cut the big root that was exposed, and so I was just gonna yank the big root up. And so I went, George, I promise you to God, I went to yank the big root up, and I said, "Oh my God!" I went to yank the root, and the root didn't move. And so I'm looking at the root because I have cut the root. Y'all don't even understand. I cut it this way. I cut it that way. I reached in. I had my gloves on. I had my glasses on. And I reached down to yank this root up. And I promise you, it almost pulled my arms, both of them, out of socket. I had to pray in the back. I said, "God, look, you know. Oh, God, you know. What is going on?" And I found out that while there are roots that are exposed, that there are also, Chris, some roots that are not exposed, that are not even big. They are little roots, but they attach to the big root. But the little bitty roots won't let go. And because they were hidden, because they were not exposed, I did not know where to cut. So I had to dig deep. I had to dig deep till I saw them little jokers. Oh, God! I tell you what, Chris, I start cutting little roots. And then all of a sudden, the Lord spoke to me, and he said, "That's why I died." I said, "What you talking about, God?" He said, "That's why I died." I said, "I'm a little slow. What do you mean?" He said, "Many people think I died for sins that were exposed." That's good. He said, "I died not just for the sins that were exposed. I died for them little jokers that was hidden. I died. Okay. Let me see if I can help you. I found out that it's the little roots that feed off of the big roots. And the little roots know if you cut the big root, they can't live. And so little roots of hatred, little roots of God, of jealousy, little roots hang on, because they know if you cut everybody's sin. The loss you can't get over. They can't nobody see. No one would ever know. That you're an undercover alcoholic. Because it's not an exposed issue. It's a hidden issue. No one would ever know you got pornography issues. Because it hasn't been exposed. It's a hidden issue. No one would ever know you have abandonment issues and low self-esteem issues. Because they're not exposed. They're hidden.
Outside in the backyard.
She came out the door because she looked out and saw that I was dancing in the backyard, and she was wondering, what are you dancing about when it looked like he's supposed to be working? And the reason why I was dancing was because I had just cut a little root that had been giving me trouble for like 15 minutes. so much for